Starting the second lectures, and we have Gabriele Ferretti that is going to teach us about advanced supersimples. Please.
Okay. Hi, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. As I'm very, very happy to see some old friends, which I thank for the kind invitation. But I'm also very happy to see you guys, which is even more exciting because today I know. But you, I don't. And some of you will become one of the leaders of theoretical physics in the next generation. And in which case, it would have been a pleasure and an honor for me to have been wasting some of your time today. And in this picture. So, about 3 months ago, I don't remember who, Domenico Carlo, I don't know, wrote me an email and said, would you like to lecture about advanced topics in supersymmetry. And I was so looking forward to coming here that I said, yeah, sure. But then I said, no, I can't lecture about advanced topics in supersymmetry. So when I wrote the short plan for the lectures, which you will get, it's a short PDF file. I actually, the title, they didn't notice this, but in the title I wrote, not so advanced topics, which is much more to my liking. So let me tell you more concretely what the plan of these lectures will be. So I will start with a reality check. And an introduction. This form I know might take all of the morning. I don't know. And it may go very, very badly wrong depending on the computer and the connection, and we will see. It's something that I do for myself. You're just the guinea pigs on one thing that I will show you in a second. But then the real business will start, and I decided to divide the lectures in two parts. Part A, so the whole thing will be about four-dimensional, rigid, n equal to 1 supersymmetry. Okay? In part A, we will discuss some of the most important discoveries about, let me just write it here, before I write anything else, let me say. So it's going to be n equal to 1, d equal to 4, rigid. Okay? This will be the subject of the whole thing. In part A, we will discuss theories with unbroken supersymmetry. And we will discuss more specifically. So these are the canonical example, the example which is very, very rich and from which you can learn a lot of physics and a lot of techniques is supersymmetric quantum mechanics, super QCD. And with a varying number of flavors, varying number of chiral matter fields. Super QCD has been studied intensely in the 90s, and it has been essentially sorted out. All the dynamical, the possible dynamical phases have been sorted out. I will not give any references in these lectures, but of course I cannot let go of mentioning the name of Seiberg, which is really has been the one that has spearheaded the project and really led to the great successes of the 90s. I will not, but I will not give any specific references. On the other hand, I will give you a list of reviews that are very nice, on which I myself used to prepare these lectures and that you can consult. This is another of these pages that will be put online, or maybe I'll give it to you just a page. Possible. So this is the canonical example of theories with unbroken supersymmetry. We will discuss the various dynamics of this thing. More specifically, we will discuss what the moduli space of a theory is, what is a quantum deformation of the moduli space of a theory, and so on. In part B, we will break supersymmetry. Oh. we will break it spontaneously, and we will see what dynamical issues arise in that case. I won't write down the whole thing because I will give you the notes. We will introduce. We will see what a supercurrent is. We will see what the Golestino is. We'll talk about classical supersymmetry breaking, and more importantly, a dynamical supersymmetry breaking. That is, supersymmetry breaking induced by quantum correction. And we will give various examples of these various mechanisms. So this is the plan of the lecture. So before I start with anything, I would like to try a little game. Let's see if it works. But now, before I even try, I have to ask you, how many of you have the possibility of connecting to the internet in 30 seconds or a minute? Not many, okay. Without pain, I mean, if you're coming from, but I mean, how many of you have a computer? You know, should we give it a try? Raise your hands. Show me. Only not this. So here.
Yeah, now.
No, yeah, with a laptop or anything. No, it's too few. It's too few. No, I can't do that. And it's not worth it, because then it would be. I will almost know who is answering to what questions. So, no, then forget that. We'll just quit this thing. And, because it was a nice iterative way of asking like multiple choice questions that I've been playing with, and I wanted to test it on you. Never mind. I should have prepared this better. So, right. So let's get rid of this. But then let me ask you, let's do the reality check by voice. I have been told to assume the basics of rigid supersymmetry in four dimensions, and I will. But just to set the speed, and just to know a little bit. You know what the level of the audience is. Let me just ask you some very, very basic questions. Everybody, we're not even going to need much of this, but just to know the sort of level. I mean, how many of you know what a Kähler potential is? You have to. If you raise your hands, you have to raise them high because I can't see. Okay. All right. How many of you know how many fields are required to write down the Orafferty model? How many of you have heard about the Orafferty model? Okay. All right. How many fields do I need? How many of you have heard about a superpotential? Okay. If I want to write down a renormalizable superpotential, it's a polynomial, right? What kind of degree does that polynomial need to have to be renormalizable in four dimensions? Shoot. If you know the answer, say.
Three.
Everybody's happy with that answer? I mean, how many of you knew the answer?
Okay.
All right. So, all right. No, just to know, there is no, I mean, it's not like, this is not a test, it's just to make sure that I know like how fast I should go with certain things or not. And so then, again, before we do anything, why are we so obsessed with supersymmetry to begin with? Why are we so obsessed with supersymmetry? There is no right or wrong answer here, really. But before I tell you why I'm kind of obsessed with supersymmetry, why I like supersymmetry, I would like to know why are you, I mean, this is all about supersymmetry. Why, what is your motivation to study supersymmetry? Who dares giving me an answer?
The moduli space is easy to compute.
The moduli space is easy to compute. That's an answer. Okay.
You have nice constellations.
All right. That's another answer. More?
It's
It's an interesting way of circumventing the Kalman Mandela theorem by studying the algebra to a graded algebra.
It's a nice way to get around the Kalman Mandela theorem. That's an answer. Great, great. Keep it coming if you wish. Okay. How about it might be true? it might be a symmetry of nature, right? If it isn't, or better yet, if we cannot prove experimentally that supersymmetry is a solution of is present at the energy scales that we are investigating now at the NXC, for instance, then all of your answers are excellent answers, because supersymmetry will remain forever, no doubt about it, an important piece of theoretical physics and mathematical physics, because it allows us to bring under control extremely difficult dynamical aspects of gauge theories that we would like to solve even for no supersymmetric theory, but we are somewhat limited by our technical abilities. For instance, chiral symmetry breaking, confinement, and all of these issues are, of course, very important issues that are very relevant even to real-life QCD, but we still would like to know a little bit better. Whereas in supersymmetry, we will see examples of theories which have chiral symmetry breaking or no chiral symmetry breaking, confinement, and so on. You can really explore a whole zoo, and it's very well under control because the modular space is under control, it's easier to compute, and so on. But it still would be nice if supersymmetry was actually a symmetry of the world, right? How many of you have, so that's the other thing, the other email exchange I had with my colleagues was, I wrote very quickly, am I allowed to say anything about phenomenology? And they wrote, no. but I'm going to do it anyway. Just 1 minute. So, what is the particle that, or the set of particles that before the LHC was turned on, people were really hoping would just come out by the bucket? Does anybody know the name of these animals? So what is the LHC? What is the LHC? It's a collider, right? What does it collide? Protons with protons, right? And at what energy?
15.
Okay, the last one, the one that was accomplished so far is 8, right? And then the hope is to go up to 13 or 14 when it starts again, because now they're fixing it. Okay, and so that's pretty heavy. So what kind of particles were expected by the supersymmetry aficionados to come up first? Sorry, what?
Wimp?
Not really, actually, because being wimp, being sort of weakly interacting, they certainly could be there. In fact, they probably are lighter if they exist at all, but they interact very lightly, so their cross-section is very small. So the ones that were expected to come out at first were the ones that were interacting very strongly, so their cross-section would be very large. They were the squarks and the gluino, right? And so these are the same animals that we will study in when we study super QCD. Exactly the same. This is a nicer and more under control theory because supersymmetry is unbroken, whereas in real life, if supersymmetry is present at all, it's broken. Why? Why does supersymmetry have to be broken?
Right,
we will see the part, because otherwise all particles would have a partner that have the same mass. Good. So, so it has to be broken, and that is why we like broken supersymmetry. Broken in an intelligent way that makes us feel all happy, because otherwise if it's ugly, we don't like it. But so this, but super QCD, as by itself is not phenomenologically relevant, but it has the same, deals with the same animals that were expected to show up at the LHC in a different context. And it teaches us a lot about non-perturbative physics. So, right. And last thing before we start the introduction, what are the current bounds so for these gluini and these quarks We were hoping that they would show up, but they haven't. That means that the experimentalists have been able to put some bounds and said that they do not exist up to a certain max. Does anybody know what that mass would be, the order of magnitude of that mass? Yeah, it's about a TeV. Nowadays, it's about a TeV for the colored particle. There is, of course, a lot of caveats that could be made. So a TeV is 1,000 times heavier than the proton. So it is time to worry or to become even more excited about the coming run. But so that's the only thing I will say about phenomenology. But I wanted just to make sure that you understand when we study super-QCD, we're talking about quarks and gluinos. They are the same animals that make the standard model. But this is a different theory. It's much more easy to study. It's much more under control. When we talk about Broca supersymmetry, we do it not just because it's fun, but which it is, but also because if supersymmetry is the symmetry of the world, Broca supersymmetry is the way to implement it. And so, all right, so let's start with the introduction. So the introduction will be even more chaotic than the rest of the lectures. The rest of the lectures will be chaotic, but this one will be even more chaotic because I will probably skip around and talk about things that perhaps, you know, most of you know. And it might even be difficult to see the connection. But what I want to motivate in this introduction is the way that I think we should think about supersymmetry, namely that supersymmetry is a translation in superspace. So since we're talking about translations, well, let's talk about translation then. Remember that, forget supersymmetry now. Forget supersymmetry. What is a translation in space? So what is a symmetry to begin with? Well, remember that a symmetry, a global continuum unbroken, we will see how to deal with the broken case. Symmetry, forget supersymmetry, is realized by a unitary operator acting on some Fock space of states. So if I have a multiparticle state psi, this guy will give me some new rotated state in the Fock space that I call psi prime. Okay, any unitary operator can be written as the exponential of some generators, and the generators of translations are, of course, the momenta. So phi mu now, you know, if this is unitary, this has to be emission. The exponential of an emission operator is unitary. So phi mu are also operators in Fock space. And they are an emission, they commute with each other, there are four of them, and they are the generator of the translation. What does it mean for that to be a generator of the translation? Well, suppose we take left O of X be some operator, some quantum operator in some inner space. So compute psi O of X. Right. And make a unitary transformation, make a symmetry, make this kind of symmetry transformation on the state psi. Well, this will go to psi prime, which is psi u dagger O of x, times psi prime, which is u psi of x. So, psi. Okay? Now, if this u has to be called a symmetry translation, then it better be that the operator O obeys this equation, which, because that's what we mean by translation, x is a point in space-time, and x plus a is the translated point. Now, if you write u as the exponential of p, and you write the first order in the Taylor expansion for both of these two terms, you get that the commutator of u with o has to be equal to I of x. Can you see why I can go from here to here? I write u as 1 plus iat, and u dagger as 1 minus iat, and I pull out the first piece, the piece that is linear in A, and I get a commutator, some I that I fix later, and it's right, and this is the first term in the Taylor expansion. If I write O of X as O of X plus A as O of X plus A times the derivative of X. Okay? Everybody happy with this? Right. Good. So this object here, I can also call P. It's a different type of P. This P, script P, is an operator in the Fock space. And this is just a derivative. Let me call it little p of O X. Okay? So this is what the algebra of translation does on our little operators. The canonical example, of course, is if I have a scalar field, non-supersymmetric. Say, let me just do schematically. Remember that the scalar field can be written as, in terms of three scalar field, in terms of creation and annihilation operator, you get stuff like this. And then how would I write the momentum operator? Everybody knows that, so just to remind you, you can check that. K0, of course, K0 is the energy, so K0 would be the mass plus the three momentum square of the particle, so the four momentum would be then just given by this. And you can play, I didn't write the normalization properly, doesn't matter. You can play the commutator using the canonical commutation relation of the creation and annihilation operator. You can check that indeed this algebra is satisfied. Okay, big deal. Now, if an object behaves like this, so if an object obeys this, then we say it's a translational invariant field. Okay? So this object here will be then a translational invariant field. Phi will be a translational invariant field. Phi is a field. Great. Now, the products of fields, if you are careful about the sort of equal space-time divergences that occur, the products of fields, naively, they have to be translational invariant as well, because if I have two or more fields and I apply these together, I will also get the same thing. And in fact, it's true. You can regulate them in a translational invariant way. How about this thing? Suppose I have a field. Is this thing a field? Is this thing translational invariant? It has an index, it's a vector index, but can I say it's translational invariant? Well, I have to check if this is true, right? Is it true? I have to put this thing here inside the commutator. This is an operator in Fock space, so all it does is to go through this derivative. It doesn't do anything. It acts on the creation and annihilation operator. And, let's put it nu here. And then, when I put it here, all I have to realize is that the derivatives are commuting, they're exchangeable. So indeed, this is a translational invariant operator. Okay? Because it obeys that. Put it in and it obeys it. How about this guy? Is this a field? Can I call this object O of X and say it's a field? Yes or no? No, you're shaking your heads, and that's good. Keep shaking and tell me why. If I put it in, balance it. What are you doing? Say phi. Take phi. So I want to check whether this is true. Is it true? No. Why? Because here, the x just pulls out. P is an operator, it just acts. So this is x squared p mu phi. D mu, on the other hand, does not commute with x. So it has an extra piece when d mu acts on x that I certainly don't want. And then there is the piece that would do me good. But so it doesn't work, okay? Because there is an extra piece. This extra piece was not there when I had the derivative because it commutes. All of these things are exactly the same way for supersymmetry. Before, actually, let me say one more thing about this. Why do we like translation invariant? Apart from the fact that it's a symmetry of nature. So once we have the fields, so having fields, so translational invariant fields, and a translational invariant measure, which is D for X, nothing but the usual flat space Riemannian measure. These two guys allow me to write down translational invariant operators that don't depend on X. For instance, I can write something like omega, integral of D for X, some field X, and I can check that U omega U dagger, or the dagger was on the left, is equal to U, is equal to omega. So this is a translational invariant operator. How do I know that? One line proof, of course, and then we move on to supersymmetry. I know that because I can say that I can bring this inside, so U dagger omega U is equal to D for X U dagger O of X U, and this is equal to, because this is a transition invariant object, this is equal to theta of X plus A, but then I can call this X prime, and this is transition invariant, so this is the same as the four of X prime, and so I get back home here. Simple as that. Let me move on to supersymmetry now. So we want to do exactly the same thing with supersymmetry. And so it's, and I will not give a full full derivation. In fact, I will not derive anything, but I will try to see, to make you see the analogy with the things that we have just said. So, let me just say one thing about notation. The notation, which will be, I say it only for political correctness, but you will see that, in fact, I warn you that you will see that we will be able to do lots of things with supersymmetry without ever mentioning Frobenius. It's a funny thing with supersymmetry. The more sort of advanced the problems you're trying to attack, the less complicated the calculations become. I mean, the real sort of devilishly part of supersymmetry is when you have to check all the signs and all these things. We will not do much of that, if anything. But I have to tell you a little bit of notation. Once you have gone past that and introduced the concept of superfields and so on, you can get a lot of mileage without ever talking about Fermi's, it's something, I guess, to be grateful of, because the Fermi's are the trick. So the notation for dimension, we will use the Weyl presentation for the gamma matrices, where sigma mu is the identity, the 2x2 identity matrix, and for sigma 0 and sigma I for the Pauli matrices, and it will be written as with indices alpha and alpha dot. Alpha and alpha dot are the two component left-handed and right-handed Weyl indices. This is the standard notation that you can read off, that you can learn in Wessenbach and so on. And sigma bar is essentially the same thing, up to a sign. There was a question? Please feel free to jump in anytime. And if you see that the mistake I'm making is too embarrassing, maybe don't wait until we turn off the camera. But if it's somewhat something that can be said in public, by all means, knock yourself out. So, And so the convention is that you put the alpha, the indices alpha and alpha dot downstairs when you have the sigma mu. With the sigma bar, you put alpha dot and alpha upstairs. And the other convention is that probably the only thing that we need to really know is that, so at the Dirac spinor, psi can be of course decomposed into a left-handed and a right-handed spinor, which is called lambda chi and lambda with the appropriate indices. And for instance, two objects of this type can be made, say, I can contract them if chi and psi are left-handed objects. I can define the product without putting any indices, and this is defined to be chi alpha psi alpha, where the indices are lower than raised with the epsilon tensor. So, where if I told you what this thing is, I have to tell you what this thing is. So chi alpha is equal to chi beta, where I erase the beta with an epsilon alpha beta, which is of course the invariant metric for the spinor indices in the alpha beta basis. And the same thing for the alpha dot, there will be an epsilon alpha dot beta dot. For those, this is not an explanation of anything, this is just a summary of the notation. If any of you has never seen this or is not completely familiar with it, we can talk to you in the break, and there is plenty of material where you can just go and catch up. But this will not be, this is just so that you know what kind of notation I'm using. So, let me go back and say a few words about supersymmetry as a translation in superspace. So we will do, just briefly again, the same thing that we did for translations, but now with supersymmetry. So, and this is to introduce our main friends. So instead of a field, we introduce a superfield, which will be a function, an operation-valued function of not just the space-time coordinate x mu, but also some Grassmann coordinates, theta alpha and theta bar alpha dot, where alpha and alpha dot, as before, go between 1 and 2. 1 and 2. You can put the dot here, but there is no integer called 1 dot. So something, you can just call it 1 and 2, just, as long as you know it's a dot. There's another set of integers that is used. I say these things, but they were actually very confusing to me when I started learning the subject, actually. Just in case. So now I take a field to depend on both theta and theta bar. Now the good news is that theta, so this looks, oh god, this is more complicated, but the good news is that theta and theta bar are anti-commuting objects. And so if I do a Taylor expansion of this field in powers of theta and theta bar, this Taylor expansion will terminate. So I will start off with, for instance, the part that does not contain any field, any theta and theta bar, this would be a scalar. It could be something else, actually. It doesn't have to be a scalar. I could have some Lorentz indices here, in which case these Lorentz indices would go along for the ride, and they would belong to this phi as well, and to the other components as well. Let me start with something here that does not rotate. We didn't talk about the rotation, but let me start with something that does not carry any index. So it's a rotationally, it's a scalar. So if I do the first term in the expansion, rotationally it will be a scalar as well. And then I will expand with all the other thetas and so on. And so the first term would be, for instance, something that is proportional to theta, theta alpha. Theta alpha then will need another field, which we call, I don't know, psi alpha of x, plus dot dot dot. I do all the Taylor expansion, and the last field I get will be the highest possible powers of theta and theta bar that I can get are 2 powers of theta and 2 powers of theta bar, where theta square is obtained exactly in the same way as we did here. So theta square is theta alpha, which is up to a constant, theta 1, theta 2. There are 2 of this theta, and that's what they are. The constant is probably 2 or minus 2, and don't make me fix that one now. Times another field, which is B of x. So you can play with it and check how many numbers do you get. How many independent components do you get. Now this is great, and we can even then do the same thing as we did for our scalar field. Now, so when we said, remember we said that we were making a translation in space, right? Okay. All right. Now, a translation in superspace will amount to taking theta and theta bar and translating them as well by some fermionic coordinate. Like this. And this by itself is not supersymmetric. We will have to actually make this translation talk to the x. So we will have to make a commuting. So these epsilon are now constant. The difference between the main qualitative difference between this set of lectures and the one that you learned, that you have seen before this morning, is that in rigid supersymmetry, epsilon is a constant. It does not depend on x. All right. So that's much easier. So epsilon does not depend on x, but x translate with some dependence on epsilon as well, and the correct. So let's put even the index here. Theta bar plus I epsilon bar sigma bar mu theta, and if you are index freak, you can put them in by that rule that I told you. So this is okay. All the indices. I don't know if I told you that rule, but I probably didn't. The undotted indices are contracted like that because there is always when you're dealing with fermionic indices, there is always the chance of making a sign error. Chance is actually quite high, and so you want to have your convention straight if you ever do this calculation. So the idea that is very convenient and is used in the vast majority of the literature is that when you want to take a contraction left-handed spinner, you raise the index to the left. In other words, you only contract undotted indices this way. Okay. If you were to do it the other way, you get a minus sign. On the other hand, if you want to do it for the dotted indices, you want to do it the other way, okay? And you can actually check. This is a nice exercise. It's a one-line exercise that if you haven't done, let me ask you what the answer is. So these are two fermions, right? I could contact them this way, or I could contact them this way. The beauty of this notation is that here I have a plus, not a minus. In other words, once you take into account the fact that the fermions are anti-commuting objects and that this epsilon tensor is itself anti-commuting, you actually get two minus signs. So if you flip them, you get a plus sign, which is neat because that at least is a sign that you're not going to make. So this is our translation, okay? And we will assume then that there will be, just like pmu was the generator for this. Now the translation is now generated by this larger sort of shift in, let's just assume that A is small, so this is an infinitesimal shift in X, and there will also be some infinitesimal shift in theta and theta bar, which will be generated just like, so we have P mu with Y, and face exactly the same thing as before, this Y, but now we also have the translations for theta and theta bar, which will be generated by some objects, some emission operator, some operator, not the emission in this case, Q alpha, which will be then given by some derivative object that I will get by putting in this substitution into the field, okay, and expanding, okay. Whatever I get will be some sort of derivative operator. And I will call it Q alpha, Y, and I will tell you, and the same thing will be with Q alpha dot, Q bar alpha dot. There will be exactly the same exactly the Exactly the same thing will be true for the dotted indices. So these Qs are again operators in the Hilbert space of your theory, whereas these Qs here, which are not calligraphic, sorry, I hope you see the difference between, I'm trying to make a difference between this Q and this little Q here. Now let's look at these guys. These are just like the P that we had before, the Roman script P. These are nothing but the differential operators that arise if you make this substitution and you expand in first order in H. Okay? And again, if you haven't done this exercise, this is a nice exercise to do. And the form for these Qs is something that you is something that I will write down now. And it is, so before we had the derivative in X, now we have the derivative in alpha, of course, but there is an extra piece. And similarly for Q bar, let me put the index down, is equal to, I guess there's a minus I. Dot plus alpha dot. Okay? I hope you can read. This is a derivative with respect to x mu. So these are the two differential operators that generate our supersymmetry algebra. Now, together with P, they give us the fundamental commutation, or better, anti commutation relation. Relation, which in my notation will be written as please check that if I haven't made a sign error somewhere, keeping in mind that the theta anti-commute, and so do the d thetas, if I take the anti-commutator of these two objects, what I get is essentially twice the momentum, that is twice the derivative, I times the derivative with respect to x mu. This is a check that you can make if you haven't done that. Okay? Now, for the case of these script operators, these are the big operators in the Fock space, the same is true. Same is true. For what I try to call script Q bar, and script P. Okay, they obey exactly the same commutation relation. There is, however, one thing we have to be a little bit careful about. This is the algebra, but we would like to know whether this algebra is correctly implemented on the vacuum. In other words, before we have made another assumption, I probably didn't state it explicitly, but another assumption that we have made is that this script operator annihilates the vacuum. In other words, the vacuum is translation invariant, right? Now, there is nothing that tells us that this should be true for the Qs as well. And in fact, we will see that essentially, once you have the supersymmetry algebra, the difference between supersymmetry being broken or unbroken spontaneously is whether the Qs and the Q bars annihilate the vacuum or not. So, whereas this is a something that we have to enforce because the world around us is translation invariant, this is something that we would like not to impose, because if we do, we are led immediately to the existence of partners of supersymmetric particles of the same mass as the ones that we observe. They don't exist. So this thing cannot be zero in real life. But since we're discussing formal aspects, we will start with unbroken supersymmetry. So this will be part A, okay? And then we will move on to see what happens when these things are not zero, or better yet, not well defined. and this would be the part that has to do with broken supersymmetry. Now, just before we take the break, so I try to finish the introduction before the break, and then, so after lunch, we can start with part A. So, and hopefully it will be a bit less haphazard than the things have been going so far. But so I just want to mention, so the whole point of this introduction is to mention a few things that you should be aware of. For those of you who are not aware of, you can talk to me and we can immediately sort out some reference where you can know these things. This is some sort of basic stuff that you are, that you should know. Yes? Sorry, what?
This is sufficient condition for unbroken
system. We will, there's a whole discussion that will come up in part B. But this is actually necessary and sufficient. In some way that we will specify when we discuss Whitney index and all these things. But this is actually it. So let me introduce the two. Okay, 10 minutes and then we take a break. I still have until one hour. I was just panicking because I thought it was time to go for lunch. We eat lunch very early in Sweden. So I have a biological clock telling me stop and go for lunch. You have another biological clock that stop talking and let's just do something else. But that's right. So now it's fine. We have time to do. In fact, we finished the introduction without stress, which is a good thing. So let me introduce now the two players that we will use. So these are the superfield. So I wrote the superfield Y as the generic superfield. I wrote it as phi of x plus a lot of stuff plus theta squared d of x. Now, in the case of translation, when we talked about translation, we were done. We wrote down a field, we said it's translation invariant, and we were happy with it. Now, we can do better. We can do better because I can actually, this the technical term for this is that this set here, this superfield here is technically, is a reducible representation of SUSY. What does it mean? It means that I can actually reduce it, so I can set some of this component to zero, or some linear combination of this component to zero, with that preserving the fact that this is still a field, that is, that it transforms properly under supersymmetry transformation. Now, how do I do that? I observe the following fact. Now, I erased the cues, but now I'm going to write down two things. So I'm going to define two objects that look suspiciously close to the cues that I wrote down before. These objects are d alpha, which is, if I have the cues, I would have just told you what the differences are. Let's see if you spot it. Well, first of all, I hope I write it right. But u and d bar alpha dot equal to minus d bar alpha dot. We will never need the explicit expression, but I write it for completeness. We will never need any of these things, really, but I just write it down because, just in case you haven't seen it, this is the preliminary sort of material that you better be aware of so that you know when people do things at an advanced level and they hide a lot of things inside the bonnet or the trunk, you get sort of, you know where it comes from. So here we have some objects that are not quite the same as the cubes. There are some sign differences. Apart from this silly thing, they are pretty much the same. The important thing is that all the cubes commute with all the d's, anti-commute with all the d's. And again, if I didn't make any sign error, you can check yourself. This is both q and q bar. Eh? So bar d, q bar, q bar. But they're all zero because of this funny choice. So why do I care about this? This is nice because given d, then I can impose a condition on the superfield,
why?
That preserves supersymmetry. So, namely, I can say that, say for instance, B bar alpha dot on Y is equal to zero. An object of this type is called, it's irreducible, and it's called a chiral superfield. And this will be one of the two players in our game. We will construct our theory out of chiral superfield and another type of superfield that we will introduce momentarily, which is called the vector superfield. These are the two players of our game. Now, but first let me ask you, what does it mean? Because this is what's written in the books, but what exactly does it mean? Remember what we did for the translation of the invariant field, right? So, what do I mean by saying that I can impose that condition without breaking supersymmetry? What does it mean that I can impose this condition but preserve supersymmetry? It's the same thing as saying that this condition is invariant under supersymmetry. What does that mean? Well, you see, you have to try the. So how does, I want to enforce this condition. Suppose I make a supersymmetry transformation of Y. Well, this would be then, let us say with Q. So this is the supersymmetry transformation of Y. But this, if Y is a field, this is Q of alpha. So now you got yourself, so this thing here becomes V bar alpha dot Q of alpha on Y. And for this to be a supersymmetrically consistent condition, it has to be invariant under supersymmetry. I have done the supersymmetry transformation, I get this, and now, since Q and D anti-commute, I get minus Q D bar on Y. But this is zero, because D bar on Y is zero. So the fact that I have an object, the importance of this thing is that I have an object that anti-commutes, it would have been fine if it commuted, that just happens to anti-commute with the supersymmetry charges, with the supersymmetry generators, and then that means that if I change Y, then this thing is still okay, right? There is no such object there is no such interesting object without supersymmetry, because for instance, I could forget supersymmetry. I could just impose, forget supersymmetry, I could impose this condition on the generic field. This is a translational invariant condition, but I haven't reduced anything, I just set the field to constant, right? I kill all of the x dependence here, right? Well, this is perfectly fine, this is a translational invariant condition. Not very useful, right? This is useful because it reduces the amount of fields without setting them all to zero, okay? So, fields of this type are called chiral superfields, and they are what we put matter into. In other words, in the standard model, say if you want to supersymmetrize the standard model or whatever theory you have, the quarks and the leptons and so on will all be put into a chiral field. So we will talk about quarks and squarks as elements, the scalar and the fermionic element of a chiral superfield. So typically, one writes phi and not y. So typically, if you have a chiral superfield, you call it phi. So for us, it will always be phi. Okay. So phi, it will be the same as y, but with some components set to zero or related to each other. In fact, it's a very convenient way to write it is to write So it's still it's a component of is a function of x theta and theta bar. But observe the combination one, so little script y, nothing to do with the field, y mu equal to x mu plus I theta sigma bar sigma mu theta bar. If I make this combination, this y here is already sort of chiral in a sense. So it's already killed by the d bar. This makes my life easier because I can simply then write this field not as a function of three objects, but as a function of two objects. Function of y and a function of theta. Because theta is also left invariant by this guy. So this is very convenient now because I only have one theta. And one theta, with one theta, I can only go up to how many powers of... So remember, the theta has two components, theta 1 and theta 2, right? How many thetas can I... So I start out with phi y, all right? Plus, how high can I go? How many terms in the expansion do I get? So, but you have to speak louder because I'm going deaf amongst the other problems. So,
theta
squared. Good. So, and of course there is a mythical square root of 2 that is there just to make your life apparently more difficult at the beginning, but actually easier towards the end because there are lots of 2s coming up, and this is taking care of most of them. And then you get theta squared, which is theta 1, theta 2, times f of y. So my super field will be written as a function of these three. But now I still have to do one little step in the expansion, of course, because this guy is a function of y, it's not a function of x. If I want to write it as a function of x, what do I do? Well, I do a Taylor expansion, because this is an infinitesimal quantity, no matter what you do. Because it terminates after I square it, after I square it. I can take it, I can square it, and that's it. So, because again, I have too many thetas, and that gives zero. So this thing here with that can be expanded, if you need it, as this plus, I don't know if I dare doing the calculation, because, well, the first term is infinity, I have x, and then there is another term, which you are more than welcome to figure out yourself with two derivatives and two theta, no, yeah, something like that, which you are more welcome to figure out yourself. You will not hear it from me. And so that's the full, if you really want to have the field, the kind of field in its full glory, you can write it that way. We will never need this, but just so that you know, it's good to know that there are some derivatives coming up here because, sometimes, for instance, well, let me just say one thing before we take the break, or should we just take the break? I think we should just take the break. I want to take the break. We'll take the break. Okay, so welcome back. So there was a question in the during the break. I told you that a chiral superfield obeys this condition. Of course, an anti-chiral superfield will obey the opposite condition. But just to remind us that this anti-chiral will put a bar here. When we see actually that there is a complex conjugation involved. Then the question that was asked in the break was, well, what if you impose both conditions? If you impose both conditions, then certainly, if this is supersymmetric invariant, this is supersymmetric invariant, you can impose both, you can do that, but what you get is essentially the same trivial condition that you could also do in a non-supersymmetric space, namely, that the field phi is constant. And so that's not something you may want to do. There is all this twisted, you can introduce a twisted superfield, of course, in two dimensions. Even in four dimensions, you can introduce something that's called the linear superfield, which essentially is it's another way of writing. Yeah, but this you cannot do in four dimensions. That's what I'm saying. There is a, we were just talking about another question that arose, it's like how specific these things are and so on. They are very specific to the number of dimensions that you're playing with, to the number of supercharges that you're having. We say n equal to 1 because we have one supercharge. It could be, in other theories, you could even have many charges labeled by an extra index here, which is an R symmetry. We will not discuss that. We will talk about R symmetry later in another context, but we will not discuss sort of the possible non-abelian R symmetry that would arise if you have more supersymmetries, more supercharges, and in fact, in four dimensions, you could have n equal to 2 and n equal to 4. And then the commutational relations change. It's all very subject specific. Here we're discussing four dimension n equal to 1. So these are our two friends. So now we know everything now, so we can actually ask ourselves, for instance, how do the components, let me just do this. How do the components, so so let me write. So I can write this as follows. And now you're saying, oh, he's making a mistake, because this is an x and this is a y, but I will fix that mistake by writing plus dot dot dot. Where the dot dot dots are the derivatives. Because if I put this, the exact formula would have a y here, but if I Taylor expand, I get an x plus derivatives. Here I can Taylor expand, I get one extra piece, because there's a theta, I cannot make more. And here I don't get anything, this is x. Y and x is the same thing. I could put a y here, or I could put an x here, I get the same thing, because there is already a theta square, and that's it. So that means that there are no, in particular, there are no derivatives on f. Okay? Now that we have that, we can actually, if we know it's a superfield, then we can actually ask ourselves, we can actually find the following, so we introduce this epsilon, which is this two-component constant, in this case, anti-commuting spin, and commute it with phi, big phi, and what is it going to do? Well, it's going to commute with little phi. Is going to commute with plus the root of 2 epsilon 2 theta psi plus dot dot dot. So I can just take each of these components and commute with epsilon q. Notice that if q is an anti-commuting object and epsilon is an anti-commuting object, the whole thing is commuting. So here I'm allowed to use commutators. But now I also know that this is the same as what I wrote as q, well, epsilon in this case, epsilon q acting on phi, but this q now are the derivative operators that I wrote down before. And this gives me, for instance, what does q, remember what q was? Let us just remind ourselves what q was, just to see the first piece. Q of alpha was essentially I d d theta plus minus the signs and so on are not important. What is important is you notice that there is a derivative with respect to theta and a derivative with respect to x. Right? So in particular here you're not gonna get any phi of x. You're gonna get so phi does not have a theta. So here there is no theta, so the derivative with respect to theta of this thing will be zero, and the derivative of phi with respect to when I act with this object, I will get derivative, so I will get stuff that belongs to the dot dot dot. So here there will be no theta. However, there will be a term with psi, because when I act with q on this object, well, the derivative with respect to theta, looks for a theta, here is a theta, it's all happy, it takes it away, and it becomes plus I square root of 2 epsilon psi, right? So epsilon, remember, epsilon q is epsilon alpha q alpha, q alpha looks for a theta, finds a theta, takes it away with the derivative, and gives me this. plus, not only plus, you can find all sorts of things. Let me just write the next one. If I have it, it's something which looks like theta, well, epsilon theta f, but never mind. If I don't have it, I don't want to get it wrong. It's 2i epsilon theta f plus dot dot dot. So now we actually, by matching this with this, we know we can actually write down all the supersymmetry transformations of the fields. Because you see, what can this thing be? This thing is the only object in this expansion that does not have a theta in it. Here there is a theta, and here there are other thetas. If this thing has to be the same as this, it has to match with the only object in this expansion that does not have a theta in it. Right here. So this better be the same. Okay? So by playing this game, we can actually write down all the supersymmetry transformation of the components of the field, which is then what you would use in component field in component notation. So you would say then that you would say that the supersymmetry transformation of a scalar field phi then is equal to, I think there is a 1 over, in this notation there is a 1 over I square root of 2. So this is the definition. I define it to up to I square root of 2. I think that's correct. And this is then equal to, so how does phi transform? Phi transforms as epsilon psi. So these are the supersymmetry transformations that you see when you learn supersymmetry component notation. This is the first thing you see. This is a map from a boson to a fermion that uses an anti-commuting parameter epsilon. Okay? Let's play one more step. Let's look at the guy here that depends only on one theta. It's right here. So this tells me that the supersymmetry transformation of f of psi, supersymmetry transformation of psi, let me write it in with an alpha here, because psi by itself has an alpha. So I want to, you know, I want to look at the, so this theta will pull out, and I want to look at whatever is proportional to theta, and whatever is proportional to theta is right here. Right? So epsilon theta is, of course, this. I guess you have to be a bit careful with the sign, but what you get at the end of the day is that this is equal, again, 1 over, I hope the signs are correct. Epsilon alpha f. So forget this piece. This is just the definition of the transaction, but the important thing is that then the scalar gets mapped to the fermion. The fermion gets mapped to this f, which is another scalar, which, however, is a bit funny because it does not have a derivative in it. So there are no derivatives of this f in the expansion of the superfield. We will see that that is an important point. I should probably tell you the name. This is called an auxiliary field. We will see that this field has no dynamic in itself. We'll see it in a second. And you can go like that. Check, for instance, that this delta epsilon of f is equal to, can anybody guess what delta epsilon of f is? This is a total derivative. But this one is even better. This one is zero, which is a total derivative. Whereas delta epsilon bar of f is equal to a total derivative of some mess. In fact, yeah, well, that's right. So you see, I've done the delta epsilon now. Now, to do the epsilon bar, the field phi is an important point. The field phi is chiral. That means that it does not transform the same way out under the epsilon and the epsilon bar supersymmetry, right? So you have to check. So they're both important, but they're different. Because I have imposed a condition here which singles out one type of indices. So what I checked here is the easy one, the transformation under the epsilon, the one that has the same chirality as the phi. But if I want to do this one, I can do that, of course. It's a little bit more work. And then I have to pick up the derivatives. Then I have to be careful with the derivatives. And for instance, as you were saying, the last piece of the pi is here, is that I epsilon bar sigma bar mu d mu psi. This is actually an important point, so thank you for bringing it up. Delta f as another interesting property that is either invariant under half of the supersymmetry, or the other half is a total derivative. Okay, we will see that is an important point. So this was the construction of, apart from this reducibility of the field, this is the same as asking that the field is translation, is invariant under translation of superspace. Now that I have a superfield, now to make a supersymmetric invariant object, say an action, I need superfields, okay? That is, things that transform properly under shifts of the superspace coordinate, and a super translation invariant metric. This is so easy, you see, very easily done in flat superspace. You just put the usual metric, and then you multiply by d theta squared, d theta bar squared. Well, what do I mean by that? So d theta squared is again d theta 1, well, d theta alpha. So there are two thetas here, right? So it's up to some coefficient is d theta 1, d theta 2, right? So d theta bar is d theta bar 1, d theta bar 2, okay? And each of these things as a Grassmann integration, is a translational invariant object. Now, I assume, again, this is not going to change your life if you don't know this, but I assume that you know what a Grassmann number is, and that this integration defined as, do you know what a Grassmann integration is? Everybody's happy with that. If there is a vast majority of you, how many people are desperately unhappy by the fact that they don't know what a Grassmann integration is and they would like you to say it now? If you phrase the question that way, it's not going to be answered positively. So if you want, we can discuss it during the break. So this is translation invariant, we're all happy. So we have a field, we have a translation invariant metric, we can do, we can write anything we want. For instance, and so the first action that we would write, for instance, would be take a translation invariant, and then I can take any function of superfields. I will write it as if there was only one, but there could be more. I can take any function k of both phi and phi bar. They could have indices, of course. If this function is a real function, then this term here is certainly translational, is certainly supersymmetric invariant, is the product of a bunch of superfields, and this k is called the Kalor potential. Okay, this is the k. Okay, it's a real function of both the phi and the complex conjugate of the phi. So this bar here is really sort of the dagger of the phi that I had before, but there could be more. Okay, and it's a real function. Okay, so this is certainly okay. For instance, and this was one of the questions that I had before, if I just write k equal to, if I have one field on, and I write phi equal to k bar, phi bar phi, which looks simple enough, I get essentially the theory of a free scalar field and a free theory. So what I get is essentially, so if I put this in here, I get that this is the integral of, let me not check too much of the signs, but I get this, plus I get the Dirac, plus I get something that is completely trivial at this point. I just get f bar f squared, the presence of this field with no derivatives on it. And this is what I get if I put this stuff in here. Now the question, it's always confusing the first time you see this, because people write, so this is equal to the integral dx squared, dx4, theta bar squared, theta squared, of 5 alpha. Okay? This is what I said. But then, you see, and they say this is the kinetic term. But then the question is, where do the derivatives come from? And the derivatives come exactly from those dot, dot, dots that I did not write down. Right? If you take this phi, so you have to put phi to be a chiral superfield, but otherwise it would not work. If you put it to be a chiral superfield, then you're forcing some of the components in its tummy to have derivatives on it. And if you do the thing, you take the product and you pick out exactly the pieces that have four, two thetas and two theta bars, you get this. Right? So this is a theory of a free complex, this is a theory of a free massless complex scalar and a violent spin. And some junk, some object here that can be clearly, at this point, can be integrated out, can be ignored, because it doesn't do anything. We will see, however, that it does something, because there is another way, there is another term that I can add to this action. I can also write the following thing. I can stop, and this is a little bit tricky, because if I can stop my invariant measure only at the theta, without including the theta bar. And I can decide to introduce a function w that depends not on phi and phi bar, but only on the phi, not on the phi bar. So it's an holomorphic function. Think of phi, this is the first, this is the, we are slowly moving into the place where we basically sooner or later we will forget the spinors and we will start thinking about sort of chiral superfields as sort of complex coordinates plus some fermionic stuff that follows along for the ride. So think of this w as a complex function that takes value in that is holomorphic. So it's a function of z but not of z bar. And I evaluate it I put instead of z I put a whole superfield. But it's the same thing because the first component of big phi, of the superfield phi, is a scalar. Is it written anywhere? Well, the first component of the big phi is this complex scalar phi. So this guy can be equivalently thought of as a function of a chiral superfield or a function of a complex scalar plus some derivatives that follow fermionic stuff that follows along for the ride. This equivalence is extremely easy. It is extremely convenient because basically, many of the dynamical properties of supersymmetry, they depend on the holomorphicity of this object. And so you end up doing a complex analysis. It's really nice. You don't have to do much sort of gamma matrix algebra in this case to get these results. But I wrote it down. So first of all, this thing is not real. So I want to add the complex conjugate or the emission conjugate of this thing. So at least the action is real. The emission conjugate, of course, will have the bar here, and it will be the anti-holomorphic field here and the anti-holomorphic W here, of course. But I have not proven that this object is supersymmetric, because I dropped something here. And so how do I know that this thing is a supersymmetric invariant? And this is actually true. This is the exception to the rule. This is certainly okay. This one is also okay, and it boils down to the question, who said that f was a total derivative? You. So this boils down to this question, to this observation. The last component, so you see, the phi is a chiral field. The holomorphic function of a chiral field is a chiral field, because say, suppose that w of z as a complex number is some z plus z squared plus, I don't know. If I put a chiral field here, I get phi plus phi squared plus something. Each of these things are products of chiral fields. Product of chiral fields are chiral fields. How do I know? Take the divide, use the chain rule, then zero. So this is a chiral field. If I take the theta squared component of a chiral field, I get f, I get the last piece. Right? Remember that there was this phi, there was this psi, and then there was this f. And then I get the f corresponding to this w, but whatever it is, it better transform as a total derivative, according to this table, or zero, which is even better. The total derivative, once integrated over dx, gives me zero. So this is actually also supersymmetric in general. Okay? It turns out that this part here is difficult to study. Whereas this part here is essentially when they say completely under control, but basically under control. The properties of holomorphicity are so strong that they allow you to say things that you could only dream of saying in other contexts, but in this case you can actually say them and prove them. So, and this is what the first part of the whole lectures will be. But since I want to finish this introduction by lunch, I have to introduce the second player of our game. And the second player of our game, after the chiral superfield, is the vector superfield. So there was the chiral, and now we have the vector superfield, which is a generic field V of x, theta, and theta bar. But you assume you impose the hermeticity condition, say that V is the same as V double. So this is clearly a supersymmetric and invariant condition, and this is something you can even do without supersymmetry. If I give you a complex field, I give you a complex scalar field, is that an irreducible representation of the translation? Well, no, I can set it, I can translate it. Both the real component and the imaginary component of this whole thing are also separately invariant under translation. So that's exactly the same thing. You could do that. Here is a little bit more interesting though, because, and here I'm making a long story short because I'm not reviewing this, but you can actually, so this field here will have a lot of components that can be actually sort of gauged away, and by going, and you can actually write a simplified version of this. For those of you who have no idea what I'm talking about, we can discuss it during the break. This is not part of the lecture, but I will just say, so in a certain gauge, which is known as the best Zunino gauge, you can actually, the interesting component of this V are actually few. They are, stands out with already some thetas. So this V is a vector superfield. It might actually carry some index. Let me put the index here, because this index is important. This index is a V-algebra index, and this A is like a gluon. It is a gluon. So remember that a gluon is a vector field, so carries a mu index, but also carries a V-algebra index, and it transforms kind of, not really under the adjoint representation, but this is an adjoint index. So if I have a group SUN, this index A would go from 1 to n squared minus 1, which is the dimension of SUN. So this is like a gluon. For QCD, how many gluons are there in QCD? A. Because the dimension of SU3 is A. The adjoint representation of SU3 is A dimensional. If this was the gluon of QCD, this A would go from 1 to 8. It goes now from whatever it is. It's convenient to put it in because nice gluons there. And then you have theta bar squared theta A plus theta squared theta bar lambda A. But plus the last piece, 1/2, I guess, theta squared, theta bar squared, d. Okay. So this is the gluon. What is this guy? How do we call it? Gluon. And this turns out to be an auxiliary field as well. Now, this is the equivalent of the gluon field. But if we want to write a gauge invariant, now the goal now would be to write both a supersymmetry and a gauge invariant Lagrangian. So if you want to write a gauge invariant Lagrangian, you don't start with V, of course, because V is, it's not a gauge invariant. This thing here is not a gauge invariant. So this actually is the first exercise that I give you so that. You can, and also there is another problem. Suppose I want to make phi also carrying some representation of the gauge group. So let us say that I want to even U1, say phi is a complex field. Phi is a complex field of x, theta, and theta bar. It's a chiral field, so a place whatever it is. In fact, let me just write it as y and theta so that we know it's chiral. Let us say that this is a chiral field, and let us suppose we want to give the theory that this field belongs to, we want to give to this theory a U1 invariant. We want to make the theory invariant by a phase. Can I just do that? No. Why? So this is what you would do for a scalar field. If you have a scalar field, you can just rotate it by a phase and you get a U1 phase depending on x. So you get a gauge symmetry, a U1 gauge symmetry. Can I do that with a chiral field? No. Why?
Because they are derivative acting.
Right. It's not, this is chiral, but this is not chiral anymore. This thing is not chiral. It's just if anything is the first component of a chiral field. All right, no problem. We make it chiral. So this is a good. This is chiral. If this is chiral, then this is fine. This is also chiral. It's the product of two chiral fields. But now we have another problem. Phi bar phi is no longer gauge invariant because phi bar phi goes through phi bar e to the minus I lambda bar e to the I lambda. Fine. If lambda is a chiral superfield, you know, if lambda was a real function, then lambda bar is the same as lambda. And this is why this object here would be invariant under U1 if you didn't worry about supersymmetry. But certainly this thing is not gauge invariant anymore because lambda bar is not the same as lambda. Okay, so we fixed supersymmetry here. We got in trouble with gauge invariance here. Here comes V to the rescue. We introduce V in such a way, and this looks like a bit, the first time you see this equation, you find it a little bit, I found it a little bit hard to swallow, but you have to play with it, and in fact, it's the right thing to do. You introduce this thing. You say that this V obeys a gauge symmetry, gauge transformation, in fact, not just this, but the full, not in the verso V, but the full V obeys the following, transforms in the following way. You impose, just like you impose this, you impose this as well. Probably not. Probably I screwed up the size here. Oh, boy. Right. No, there's a minus here. And there is a plus there. Sorry. Yeah. So there will be some errors in the notes, of course. But so now that you have this, this tells you how V transform if you work out enough. It's a bit of a mess, but you can find out. And you can find out, for instance, that you can reduce to this gauge. But before doing that, you can do this, and now you have a full gauge invariant scalar potential, which you can write like this. Now this is both supersymmetric and gauge invariant, because you can check there's a supersymmetric transform. So basically, I stick this thing in here, and the lambdas and the lambda bars cancel out, and lo and behold, you got yourself a supersymmetric theory. The last thing you want to do is what is the field strength. So here we have still something with a naked A. Now, a naked A can only appear inside covariant derivatives, and they do appear if you expand this term. Again, if you have not done this, if you have not seen this before, this is not going to be very transparent. But this is not part of what I want to discuss. This is the prerequisites. Yet, I want to go through very briefly the main points so that if you haven't seen them, then come and talk to me and we'll try to fix something up. But at least appreciate the fact that this thing will not give you an F mu nu square. That will not give you a kinetic term for the gluon, right? There's no way you can do that because there is always going to be either some phi or v without something. So you have to introduce a field strength. And this is actually a homework that I gave you. And it's actually nice because you can basically write it like this. You introduce an object that again is absolutely not intuitively obvious. This to me, at least when I learned these things, this transformation and this definition here. Like maybe I can even put the normalization right. It's minus 1/4, doesn't matter too much. So this definition here is also not obvious, but what it does, it introduces for you a field that is actually a chiral field. So you can, and this is part of the homework, you can check two things. The first homework goes out to check that this W alpha, not to be confused with the superpotential. Superpotential is also called W, but it has no alphas in it. This is W with an alpha, and of course, if it is the algebra value, it has an A here as well. But let's do it for this case, as V being matrices now, V being contracted with the generators. So if W is like that, you can check that W is chiral, and you know what that means. And you can also check that W transforms in a way that is superficially similar to the way V transforms, but not quite. It transforms e to the I lambda W alpha e to the minus I lambda. The crucial difference is that there is no lambda bar. Check that with this definition, the lambda bar disappears, and this looks like exactly the same as e to the V, but without a lambda bar here. And that's good, because this being chiral, the Gauss transformation better be chiral, and this is chiral, so that's fine. And if you do that, and this is the end of essentially my introduction, and then we can go in. If you do that, then you can finally find the last piece of the information that you need to reconstruct your Gauss theory, namely that. So now that we know that W is chiral, W will contain F in a way that you will see in a second, and the derivative of the green as well. We can take W alpha squared to make a scalar. At least we want the Lagrangian density to be a scalar, so W squared. If it's the algebra valued object, you may want to put an A and square it. That is, you sum over the algebra indices. This is a chiral superfield, so you want to integrate it only over d theta squared, not d theta bar. And this indeed, plus its Hermitian conjugate, you can multiply by the appropriate coupling constant. I will not write the coupling constant. By doing all this calculation, by working out what W looks like in the Vesuvino gauge, so remember that, so this looks awful. It looks like you have to do an infinite Taylor expansion, but you don't, because in the Vesuvino gauge, which is all that we will look at, V already starts with a theta theta bar in it. Remember, the V was essentially theta theta bar with A. This means that V is important in the Vesuvino gauge. V is there, V square is there, but just barely, and then V cube is not there, because there is all the other fields are zero. So E to the V is another, well, E to the V is true if you're not in any gauge, but once you fix the Vesuvino gauge, E to the V is nothing but 1 plus V plus V square divided by 2. So this calculation can actually be easily done. You don't have to do a whole very complicated thing. And what you find is that at the end of the day, you reproduce exactly what you would like a supersymmetric theory to be. You would like it to be the theory you know and love, the pure Young-Mills theory with F mu nu as the kinetic term, plus mu nu kinetic term, and you write it with the appropriate I lambda bar A sigma bar mu d mu covariant derivative d mu lambda A plus that other V term that followed this 1/2 V square. Okay? And I haven't put in the coupling constant. You can put the coupling constant. In fact, you can even put a complex coupling constant here. If you put a complex coupling constant, you will get an extra term, which is essentially the instanton, the instanton term, FFT1. But forget that. This is what you get. So supersymmetric pure Young-Mills theory is nothing but Young-Mills theory plus a gluino, that is a fermionic field that transforms into a joint representation and has its own kinetic term with a covariant derivative, meaning that here there is of course d mu plus I a mu. So if you think of it as a commutator, you can think of it as a commutator or as a Riddle algebra with the appropriate f structure constant, just as you would covariantize any fermion that transforms into a joint representation. And you can check that, you can also do the supersymmetric transformation and all of these things. This concludes the introduction. So after lunch, we will start the actual course, I guess. And we will start by actually saying one thing that I didn't quite say now, namely, at the end of the day, when you couple this theory with this theory, you get, amongst other things, you get a potential for the scalars that are involved in this theory. And this will be our starting point. We will quickly see how that potential looks like. And that potential will then be our first handle on the dynamics. We will find a potential for these fields, for the scalar fields phi, coupled to an arbitrary gauge field. And we will see that that potential is very, very rigidly fixed by supersymmetry. And by studying it at the classical level first, and then at the quantum level, we will be able to say a lot of things about the dynamics of this supersymmetric perspective. So that's what we will do after lunch. Okay. Thank you.